the Hasselblad cameras are renowned for their iconic ergonomic design, image quality, and Swedish design. Well, for me, as a Finn, that's quite interesting. Swedish design usually refers to long instructions of things you need to build yourself and meatballs, but this is not one of them. Did you actually know that Hasselblad cameras have been used to take some of the most iconic photographs in the history, for instance, the moon landing? And now they're using Q to build the next generation of cameras. So to tell you more about that, maybe a bit about Swedish design, I'll introduce you to Richard Röjfors.
Put your hands together for Richard Röjfors, Hasselblad.
Hi everyone. Since this is an embedded speech, I thought it was good to bring the device and run the presentation from the device. Yeah, Hasselblad, we're making medium format cameras. I want to talk a little bit about our history, because our history is important to us and our products live for a long time in the market, and we learn from them when we build the next generation. And our founder was Victor Hasselblad. He was born 1906 in Gothenburg. And there is where we have the headquarters, most of our R&D and the assembly. He was a photographer and also an ornithologist. So when he was out photographing, he brought that kind of cameras, and those were a bit too big and slow for him in the nature. So he was starting to have a dream of an ideal camera. And he was very interested in photography, so he opened a store, and he made his own reproduction camera. And during the war, he made cameras for the Swedish Air Force. So that gave him the foundation. He released his ideal camera, or the first generation. It was called 1600F. He showed it in New York, and it was, at the time, revolutionary. It was a small camera. It was modular, so you can change the lens, the film holder, the viewfinder. And the word started to spread. And later on, in 57, the successor came, the 500C, which is probably the most iconic cameras ever made, mostly because of all the iconic pictures taken with it. And one of the users of the 500C was Walter Schirra. He was also an astronaut. And at the time, in the beginning of the 60s, NASA was starting to go up to space. And they brought normal cameras. And they were not so happy about the results. But Walter brought his 500 up into space and took some pictures. And the result was much, much better. So NASA actually took the 500 and made its own casing and started to use it. But later on, Hasselblad and NASA started to cooperate to make the space cameras. Can you please start the slideshow? So I've brought some pictures that are taken with our cameras. So this is Buzz Aldrin on the moon surface. And Neil Armstrong is the photographer. And as you see, Buzz didn't bring his camera. It should be mounted on the chest, so he's in the pictures on the first surface walk. Okay. And during the time until now, we have done a lot of different models. Have them there. I won't go through them. And in 2002, we released a digital system called the H system. And then the earlier system got the name the V system, V as Victor. And in addition to this, we do digital backs. So you can actually buy a V camera, or the 500 from 57, and put on a digital back on it, and you get a 50 megapixel digital camera, and you can reuse all the lenses and all your equipment. Hardware specs are driven by the sensor. Now I'm talking about our last generation, and we started with this 2015. The hardware specs, we wanted the best sensor available. So that's a 100 megapixel sensor. So that means that we need to capture those photos. And the sensor can deliver more than one picture per second, about two. So that means that we need to take care of about like 200 megapixel per second and or 400 megabyte of raw data. And we now also support video, so raw video. Up to 4K, that means 200 megabytes per second of data. So that puts some pressure on the system to do image processing on all the pictures, but also bandwidth to storage media. So we cannot use standard SD cards, so we need CFast to store our data. And the cameras are commonly used in studios, and then you connect to your PC. So we need fast links to the PC, so it's USB 3 and fast Wi-Fi to our mobile apps. And then we have HDMI out, which I'm using now. And we also have an electronic viewfinder. And the medium, I mentioned medium format for those of you who doesn't know it. That's the size of the sensor. So our sensor is to the left. And to the right, it's a full frame sensor. But in a compact camera or a mobile phone, you have a much, much smaller sensor. But the bigger sensor you have, the more light you can get in to construct your image to catch more details. So from the UI point of view, we want to have an intuitive camera. The main idea is that it should not stop the photographer from taking pictures. It should not delay him or her. And it should be easy to do the settings so you can take your pictures. We have multi-touch, mainly because to zoom and pinch in images, you can see how crisp it is. But we still have wheels and buttons. The UI has to be scalable due to HDMI. We don't know the size of the screen you connect. And we need to support multiple languages because the products are sold worldwide and we need font rendering and so on. And we heavily depend on transparency. When we show live video, we add overlays with information. This is the X1D. That's the camera I have. Now I'm showing the mechanics we built on the platform. So that's the camera I have here. So it's our first mirrorless, so it's much more compact. But since we don't have a mirror, we need an electronic viewfinder. So look through the lens, we need to run the sensor. Light comes in and you show the image on a small LCD panel. And it comes with a new lens range. But you can use the other lenses with an adapter. So software-wise, we choose Qt. That's why I'm here. It helps solve us all the requirements. I'm preaching for the choir. It gives us some good hardware acceleration we use as well. And the tooling helps us. We love the declarative language to write the UI. So that helps us to write it quickly, and we can prototype new functions. Our main issue with the UI is our big image sizes, so up to 100 megapixels. So to picture that, I have an image from a glacier from above. So it's 1024/768. But it's 100 megapixels. It means that one pixel here is 128 pixels in the original image. So in the circle, there are some people. So if we zoom in on them, they look like this. So here we can see how much information we have in the pictures. And that's what we have to deal with in the UI. And the most important part when it comes to the working with the pixels is when we pinch and zoom in images, because the user expects it to be quick. So now I'm running the UI in a demo mode. I have a disclaimer, this is not the production code. So I've done a hack in the compositor to put everything on HDMI as well. So the UI looks like this. We have like three icons to the right, which you also can access by hard buttons. And you have nine shortcuts you can put whatever function you want on. And we don't have the World Summit icon there from the beginning. And you can also control it with the wheels and buttons. And at any time, you can swipe down the control screen, so you can change settings for your next image. Like if I change the white balance, for instance, I use the touch and choose the white balance. And I can also push play to show this was here last night to see images. So we can take a demo image. Here we have one. So it's a girl with a horse. And when we pinch in this, so this is 50 megapixels. So I have this kind of performance. And if we want to look at the detail level, like here, you have the hair. There's quite a lot of details in the pictures. And of course, you can like half press at any time and you get live view. So it's here, and you can full press to expose. So. Like this. You see the picture. Yeah. So that's our camera. So, yeah, thank you. Murphy's Law.
All right, thank you, Rickard. Yeah. That's a really impressive device.